Well, good morning. It's great to have a few of you here on this, finally, a nice Sunday where we can enjoy a worship service outside together. We've got rained out, I think, the last 5 weeks in a row, and I was telling a few of you, at the very least, it'd be nice to be outside preaching, regardless of how many are here, and so it's good that we can be together. We're even two or three or four cars are gathered together. Christ will be in our midst. He's always in our midst. I mean, even if we're alone, God is in our midst. We can't escape the presence of God. But it is good as we work towards re-entering into the facility for Sunday worship. Just wanted to get us back into the Sunday morning routine at 10:30-ish. We're going to be trimming the length of our services, and we're in the process of making some changes, as all churches are, in this difficult season. But with great challenges come great opportunities. As recent as yesterday, I was in some meetings with the denomination. We were talking about just pressing into what does it look like to be wise and discern what God is calling us to as a movement across the country, and certainly for Valleyview Community Church. So we were praying for wisdom. We were praying for wisdom at our board meeting this past Wednesday and putting together a detailed plan for reentry. And wisdom is certainly, ironically, the word of the day, as we're in the book of Proverbs, a book synonymous with wisdom. So let me just open in a word of prayer, and then we're going to jump right into some announcements. I'm going to get through the sermon, and then I'm going to invite Chris to sort of close this with some songs, with a word of song. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we are grateful to be enjoying the beauty of creation out here. The sun is shining, and we're grateful that we can be gathered to worship you today. Many are not able to be with us, but we trust wherever they find themselves, whether they're traveling and enjoying the last little bit of the summer weather, we pray that they too are mindful of your presence and are finding time to worship in their own way, wherever they find themselves on this Sunday. For those of us gathered here, we trust that, Holy Spirit, you will open up our hearts and our minds. We don't need to beg or entice you to be with us, but we need to remind ourselves that whenever we open ourselves up, we will be able to receive what you have for us, recognizing that you are in our midst always. And so as we once again search the scriptures this morning in this book of Proverbs full of such rich wisdom, we pray that our minds would be renewed, our hearts would be comforted and encouraged to continue as individuals, as families, and as a church. We pray that we would be able to cultivate lives and a ministry rhythm led by your Spirit in this challenging time. So we pray blessing over our time together this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Did that kill the buzz?
A little bit. But
you're a buzzkill, Chris. You're a buzzkill.
Does that help?
Yeah, no buzz now.
Okay. There you go. You're buzz free.
Stay there. I'll pass you the guitar later, Chris.
Yeah, well, maybe not the guitar part, but yeah, up until then.
Then we'll change positions then, yeah. So I got a few announcements I want to bring to your attention, and as we're recording, this will go out to everyone who couldn't be here with us live this morning. But as I sent out in an email, if you didn't see your email yet today, I sent out a congregational survey of the board, and I thought it would be timely as summer's winding down and we're preparing to reopen the facility, just to get feedback from the congregation about the willingness to attend. And we recognize some might be really excited and willing to jump back in. Some might be a little more hesitant, and we want to respect how everybody's feeling as we will continue to walk through this COVID virus season. But knowing how many we can expect, that'll help us as we set up the sanctuary to maintain social distancing. And we're going through with a fine-tooth comb all the public health guidelines for religious services and gatherings. We're trusting our public health officials to give us some wisdom and insight, and we're putting together a detailed plan. So before next Sunday, that'll be in your inbox. You'll see a detailed sort of reopening strategy in preparation for September 20th. September 20th is the day we have planned for our first in-house gathering after 6 months of virtual gatherings. I'm personally looking forward to it. And whether we're 2 or 3 or 20 or 30 gathered, it'll be good that we can get back in our sanctuary for Sunday worship at our regular time, 10:30-ish. Also in that survey, you'll see other opportunities for volunteering in the community. We'll certainly need some greeters to be prepped. That job description will look quite a bit differently. It won't be greeting with a hug or a handshake, but with a squirt from a sanitizer bottle. And so we'll be prepping everyone who's volunteering on a Sunday. Know that we'll train you to make sure we have a safe and effective time of worship together starting on the 20th. And we're going to continue to integrate some other virtual ways to gather, thinking creatively as, unfortunately, at least for the fall season, our ability to gather outside of Sunday will continue to be a little hampered. But we want to make space in creative ways to continue to encourage and gather together. So continue to remind you also the Tapestry podcast has been one great way to do that. Every week moving forward, we'll be continuing to roll out some podcasts. If you haven't already been interviewed and you'd like to be, looking at those of you gathered, let me know or let Bonnie Paquette know. And that's a wonderful way to share our stories to encourage the body of Christ. So that's a lot of the rhythm going on. You will be getting a call from myself or a board member this week. We wanted to go through the directory and just check in with everyone as we're starting to settle in after our summer months of travel for many of us, just to check in, to pray, to hear some of your questions, concerns, and feedback as we move forward. And I want you to know that our board has been working very diligently over the summer months to keep us moving forward and keep us tuned into what God is calling us to do in this season. If you're able to give an offering, certainly we're getting by barely financially, to be honest. We're struggling like most churches, but we've been able to stay afloat thanks to the giving of many in the church continually through the summer months. As well, we've been tapping into some government grant funds and rental relief funds that have been made available by the federal government, and that is helping us as well. So most of the activity groups in the building have started to function or will be starting to function in the next few weeks as children get back to school. And they're closely monitoring all the public health guidelines, and we're in contact with all of them to ensure not only the church activities are safe, but every activity in the building is done in a safe and effective way for the community. And so if you're able to give via e-transfer, you can do that at valleyviewfinancial@gmail.com, or you can mail an offering envelope to the church as well. And we appreciate the ability of those that are able to give in this season of challenge so we can get through and continue to do what God has called us to do. Well, those are the announcements this morning. I'm going to jump right into the message I've prepared. Turn my screen brightness up here. It's a little bright. I can hardly see my notes. Let me just pray over the message, and then I want to share from the book of Proverbs, a book that's always been one very close to my heart. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this journey we've been on through the entire of Scripture. It's been really encouraging to myself, and many others have expressed likewise, to see your Spirit at work from Genesis through Revelation, the entirety of the Scripture that is inspired. And so as we zoom into the book of Proverbs this morning, a book synonymous with wisdom, we pray that it will remind us of what true wisdom is, just how important it is to cultivate a life of wisdom. And so we pray as we dig into the Scripture, we're not just trying to fill our heads with information or memorize Scripture, although that is important, but we want to engage the Scripture so we can become more like Jesus. That is always the end goal. As individuals, as families, as a church, we want to be known as a church that looks, thinks, and acts like Jesus, extending the kindness and the love and mercy of Jesus Christ to one another and this community. We pray that we'll be able to do that effectively, but we'll be able to do that wisely. Give us a spirit of discernment, especially in this season of change, this season of maybe a bit of anxiety and angst we find ourselves in. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would breathe life and wisdom upon us today and in the days ahead as a church. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, just to recap, we spent the last 4 weeks in the book of Psalms. I thought it would be good to...
Hang on, she wants to say something.
That was an amen. All right. We have one lover of Psalms there. Maybe 4 weeks wasn't enough. I don't know if that was an angry honk or an amen honk, but... We spent the last 4 weeks of the book of Psalms just looking at the different emotions that the Psalms evoke. We talked about wisdom. There's wisdom in the Psalms. We talked about the importance of lament, and certainly we're walking through a season of globally lamenting what's happening in our world. We talked about praise, the importance of praise and thanksgiving, and last week I sent the message out a couple of days ago, if you haven't heard it, what happens when we feel sort of bitterness and anger and resentment rising up. Those are emotions that are unbecoming of Christians, but the reality is sometimes, like the psalmist, we do feel some of those emotions rising up. Rather than stuffing them or acting out on those sort of bitterness and bitter and vengeful intentions that rise up, we give those to God in a healthy way in community. That's the wise way to grapple with those. And that leads us now into the next book in Scripture. We're just going book by book through this series. Reality is we probably won't get through it all by the end of the year, but it'll work out well. By Advent, getting into Christmas, we'll probably be in the Gospels, which is appropriate. And then we'll continue on in 2021. We're not in a hurry, but we're trying to see the grand sweeping narrative. We're seeing the unfolding of God's revelation, of God's love culminating in the coming of Christ. And this book of Proverbs, sort of right smack dab in the middle of Scripture, is a book of wisdom. And if I were going to give a title to the message today, I would call this message Courting Wisdom. Courting Wisdom. And it'll become clear why I'm naming that in a few minutes. But if we look at just sort of zooming out for a moment, bird's eye view of this book of Proverbs, for those of you who are interested in these details, we would sort of identify Proverbs along with Psalms and Job and some other books upcoming as sort of wisdom literature. This is the part of Scripture that's identified as wisdom literature. Wisdom is an important theme not only in Proverbs, but it's an important theme in Scripture. And sometimes just how important the theme of wisdom is in the Bible is a little bit overlooked. But certainly, if anybody is somewhat familiar with the Bible and you ask them, what is the one book of the Bible synonymous with wisdom, most people would answer Proverbs. Proverbs. That is sort of Proverbs in a nutshell. The author of Proverbs, primarily, this is the Proverbs of Solomon. So we had King Saul, King David, and King Solomon in the history of Israel, the third king of Israel. And his life was synonymous with wisdom, about at least early on. When he was given the ability to request anything, he asked for wisdom above all else, which is very telling. And because of that, he was known as the wisest person in the history of Israel to that point. Certainly, unfortunately, the end of Solomon's life is quite tragic, reminding us that wisdom should be something that we continue to seek after. It's not just something that is given to us, like we go to the doctors and we get a shot, just fill me up with wisdom and I'm good. No, it's something we need to continually try to cultivate in our lives, just like grace upon grace upon grace throughout Scripture. And so there's always room for more wisdom. There's always room to grow in the knowledge and the grace and the wisdom of God and His kingdom. And I hope today's conversation about Proverbs will help as we open our hearts and minds to allow the Holy Spirit to lead us on in growth and the knowledge and the grace of Jesus Christ. And so Solomon primarily wrote the Proverbs, but much like the rest of Scripture, as we've been discovering, they weren't just penned and dropped for everybody. They were written, and then they were taken forward generation to generation and generation. There is, if you're keeping score or taking notes, I encourage you just to look at Proverbs 25 a little bit. Proverbs 25 gives us a hint that not only did Solomon write it all during his lifetime, but later on people grabbed onto Solomon's writings and they passed it on generation to generation. It says in Proverbs 25 that the men of Hezekiah's court took some of the writings of Solomon. And if you know the timeline in the Old Testament, Solomon is one of the early kings of Israel. We're talking about 950 years before Christ. And it wasn't until about 150 or 200 years later that King Hezekiah came along. So we see that even the book of Proverbs was written, but it was evolved, it was shaped, and it was used for generation after generation after generation. Certainly our generation has an opportunity as well to dig into this important passage of Scripture. So what's the purpose of this book of the Bible? It's to impart wisdom, but not just wisdom to anyone in general, although it's certainly to impart wisdom to us. But in its historical context, the purpose, most scholars think that the book of Proverbs was specifically written to young men who were training, in the context of training to serve in the court of the king. And that's not just a historical point for the sake of sharing that point, but I think that point is important because a lot of the language and a lot of the imagery in the book of Proverbs is talking about wisdom versus folly. How to live a life that is wise versus how to live a life that is full of folly, full of missteps. And wisdom and folly in the book of Proverbs are actually personified by a woman. Wisdom is called Lady Wisdom throughout the book of Proverbs, and folly is called Lady Folly. Folly is almost pictured like an adulterous or loose woman in the book of Proverbs versus wisdom as a faithful bride or a faithful wisdom calling and inviting faithful, wise living. And that makes a little more sense when you understand that the book of Proverbs is primarily written to young teenage boys training to serve in the court. Now, I don't have a young teenage boy yet, but I've got a preteen girl and a preteen boy. I know when they hit high school, I'm kind of cringing because boys are going to discover girls and girls are going to discover boys. And so the fact that this was written to boys training to be leaders in the court, it makes sense that if they've already got women on their mind, well, let's personify both wisdom and folly as a wise, God-fearing woman versus an adulterous, loose woman. And some people accuse the Bible of being misogynistic and patriarchal, and I would say, yeah, in the culture of the day in which it was written, it was very much a patriarchal society, and women were looked down upon. But the beautiful, more scandalous thing about Scripture is how it empowers, how it raises up the role of wisdom. I mean, they could have used anything to personify wisdom in Proverbs, but they choose to name it Lady Wisdom. That's very much countercultural. That's just part of this trajectory we often talk about. The role and responsibility of the place of women in society is being redeemed throughout the Scripture, culminating certainly in the first eyewitnesses to the resurrection of Christ, being women. And so wisdom is a key theme in Proverbs. It's also a key theme in the entire of Scripture. Wisdom is actually tied to creation itself. And I just want to read a couple passages from Proverbs that speak of this personification of wisdom. In Proverbs 8, verses 1 to 5, we read these words: "Does not wisdom call out? Does not understanding raise her voice?" There it is, the personification of wisdom as a lady. "At the highest point along the way where the paths meet, she takes her stand. Beside the gate leading into the city, at the entrance, she cries aloud. To you, O people, I call out. I raise my voice to all mankind. You who are simple, gain prudence. You who are foolish, set your hearts on it." And then in contrast to the beauty and the allure of godly wisdom, we see folly also personified in the next chapter, Proverbs chapter 9, 13 to 18. We read this: "Folly is an unruly woman. She is simple and knows nothing. She sits at the door of her house on a seat at the highest point of the city, calling out to those who pass by, who go straight on their way. Let all who are simple come to my house. To those who have no sense, she says, stolen water is sweet. Food eaten in secret is delicious. But little do they know that the dead are there, that her guests are deep in the realm of the dead." And so the first nine chapters of Proverbs are really an extended introduction. They set up this imagery. They set up this constant battling towards folly and wisdom, competing for our affections, competing for our thoughts, for our minds, for our hearts, for our activities. And then from chapter 10 onward, that's when the typical Proverbs begin. And what Proverbs are, they're wise sayings. And so starting in Proverbs chapter 10, I encourage you this week even to flip through the Proverbs and track along with where we're going on this journey. You'll see they're usually just one or two statements of wisdom, statements of advice. And one thing I was thinking about, what did I want to share? There's so much I could share, and time doesn't permit to talk about every proverb, certainly. But what are some of the overarching principles that will guide us to help understand how to read and how to apply these proverbs? And the first thing I want to say, having identified the theme of wisdom throughout all of Scripture, is that these proverbs are principles and not promises. They're principles. They're principles to guide our lives. But if we're not careful, we can fall into the myth, and it's sort of widespread, or has been widespread in the Western Church, that these are promises. We just grab onto a formula, we just sort of name it and claim it and lock it in, and things will be good. And I don't think that was really the intent of these proverbs. They're meant to be principles to guide us. Sort of almost like training wheels, as we're, think of someone learning how to ride a bike, training wheels to help us stay on the straight and narrow. But even someone riding a bike with training wheels, there's less possibility they're going to falter or get off course, but there's still that possibility. And I think that's a good image for these proverbs. One of the more well-known proverbs that I want to bring your attention is Proverbs 22:6. It says, "Train up a child in the way he or she should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." Now, if we view that as a formula, we view that as a promise, then all we have to do is ensure that the child is trained up, and then everything will be good. But there's no place for the free will of that child. The child still remains a free created being. That child continue to choose, just like the parents can continue to choose how to train up that child. The child can, even into adulthood and teenage years, can choose whether to stay on the path or to sway from the path. But the reality is, if you're listening as a parent, the likelihood of your child walking in the ways of Jesus ongoing will be greatly enhanced if you can cultivate an environment in the life of that child and nurture them where they're growing, where they see and experience the grace and love of Jesus Christ in their home, in their neighborhood, in their school, in their church community. The reality is that if this was just a promise or a formula, what about the parent who comes to Jesus later in life? And they have adult children, they may read this verse and be very discouraged. Well, I didn't train up my child in the ways of Jesus. I didn't know anything about Jesus. You see how if we turn these principles into promises, they might be encouraging for some, but they can be very discouraging to others. The reality is that God is always present and God is always wooing, no matter what age we encounter Jesus. But this is a godly principle nonetheless, that as parents, whether you have biological children or there are many in the church that have been spiritual parents to me and others, that we model Jesus and we cultivate and we invite those who are younger than us to grow up and to discern the ways of Jesus Christ. Proverbs 22:6 is one of many examples which remind us that yes, there are wisdom in these proverbs, but let's not turn them into formulas where we end up just sort of naming and claiming these promises and almost like the words become magical. Now, the words in Scripture aren't magical in and of themselves. They're inspired by God, but they're meant to be latched onto as the Holy Spirit leads us and guides us individually and in community to cultivate a life of wisdom and godliness which imitates Jesus Christ. So yes, they're principles, but they're not pithy promises. Secondly, in the Proverbs, I see, again related to that, they're not promises, but they call for situational discernment. And I think discernment is the greatest spiritual gift the church needed at its inception, in its infancy. You know, you read through books like Romans and Paul's letters and Corinthians, and you'll see these lists of spiritual gifts, and they're all important, they're all necessary in the life of the church. But I think the spiritual gift that undergirds all of that is the gift of discernment. And I see that here in Proverbs. And this is the classic go-to passage in Proverbs for me. I remember learning this at a young age, and I was kind of scratching my head because I was buying into the Proverbs are promises. And then you bump into this passage and it doesn't make sense. If Proverbs are simply promises or formulas, this didn't fit into that sort of mentality. And it's in Proverbs 26, verses 4 and 5. This is a really good word for today and everything we've been going through. Proverbs 26, 4 and 5 says this. I encourage you to revisit this and pray over this week. It says this in verse 4. Do not answer a fool according to his folly, or you yourself will be just like him. In the very next verse, so verse 4, do not answer a fool. And then verse 5, it says, answer a fool according to his folly, or he will be wise in his own eyes. Well, if these verses are formulas and promises, they seem to be very contradictory. But I don't think Scripture is contradicting itself here. This is just reminding us that we need to have discernment and wisdom on case by case in different situations. And this certainly applies to face-to-face interactions. It definitely applies to social media interactions these days. I find as people have been quarantined in isolation, a lot of the emotions, good, bad, and ugly, tends to leak out on social media. I've had to take some breaks from social media over the summer. You see some wise things in interactions in the world on social media, and you'll see some foolish things. And we need to have discernment, not only what is wise and what is foolish, but when and how to interact with something or someone we think is acting or saying something that is foolish, unbecoming of Christ. And there's no easy answer. Proverbs 26, 4 and 5 says there's no simple formula and answer because life, in a sense, is ambiguous. We need wisdom. This is where the Spirit and the community of faith comes into play, so we can discern. In this situation, with this conversation or this social media post, yeah, maybe I want to engage that in a loving manner. but in a dialogue, or maybe in another conversation, whether it's face-to-face or on social media, I'm just going to let that go. I'm just going to keep scrolling or keep walking. And this is how Jesus lived, right? Jesus spent time interacting with individuals. He spent time interacting with some of the religious leaders, even, that were acting as the gatekeepers of the church of their day, so to speak. And sometimes, though, he would just walk away. He'd let people walk away. He didn't have a one-size-fits-all formula. And sometimes in the church, life would be a lot easier if we had a one-size-fits-all formula. But if the Bible was just a book of formulas, we would be worshiping the formula book rather than staying close to Christ and in community. And I think if we're reading the Bible, if we're reading Proverbs rightly, we're taking the wisdom, but we're chewing on it, we're meditating upon it, we're discussing it as we're doing this morning in our worship service and our time in Scripture, so that we're empowered and enabled by the Spirit's leading us to cultivate a life of wisdom and discernment in our actions with individuals on social media and as a church, and as a denomination. What a time we are in. We find ourselves in a unique time with unique challenges, but also unique opportunities. And so a good part of our board meetings have been simply praying and reading Scripture and just sitting and praying for discernment, not rushing to make any knee-jerk reactions or plans, but just sitting. We recognize this is a time of preparation, a time of discerning, and I hope for each and every one of you and your families, you're doing likewise, taking time simply to pray and sit at the feet of Jesus with your spouse, with your family, with trusted friends, just to cultivate a mentality of discernment and how to live wisely in these unprecedented times that we find ourselves in. Because the reality, wisdom is not simply in the book of Proverbs. In all of Scripture, we see wisdom, the word wise or wisdom is mentioned over 400 times in the Bible. And over 111 times is mentioned here in the book of Proverbs. But there's another fascinating part of the Proverbs, and I'm going to read it in Scripture. This is just a beautiful part of Proverbs. I want to read this as we prepare to close. I'm going to invite Chris to come and lead us in some song in a few minutes. But in Proverbs chapter 8, just to highlight how important wisdom is here in the Proverbs. Wisdom is actually tied all the way back to creation. So at creation, God creating everything in the heaven and the earth, that was an act of radical love, but it was also an act of deep, deep wisdom on the part of God. So beginning in chapter 8, verse 22, reading to 31, this is just one of my favorite parts of all the Proverbs. The Lord formed me from the beginning, before he created anything else. This is wisdom now, personification of wisdom speaking. So wisdom is something that finds itself in the outset of creation. The Lord formed me from the beginning, before he created anything else. I was appointed in ages past, at the very first, before the earth began. I was born before the oceans were created, before the springs bubbled forth their waters, before the mountains were formed, before the hills I was born, I being wisdom. Before he had made the earth and fields and the first handfuls of soil, I was there when he established the heavens, when he drew the horizon on the oceans. I was there when he set the clouds above, when he established springs deep in the earth. I was there when he set the limits of the seas, so they would not spread beyond their boundaries. And when he marked off the earth's foundations, I was the architect at his side. I was his constant delight, rejoicing always in his presence. And how happy I was with the world he created, how I rejoiced with the human family. Such a wonderful, poetic, visual passage that highlights the importance and the primacy of wisdom, even going back before creation. Creation itself declares the beauty and the wisdom of God. And lest we fall into another trap, a pitfall of chasing after wisdom for wisdom's sake, you know, as important as wisdom is, as the importance of Scripture is, you know, we can worship the Bible, we can worship the Scripture, we can also worship the desire for wisdom. And yet, I want to close with a passage in the New Testament, as we always do. I want to see what Jesus has to inform us about Proverbs and wisdom. And I was thinking about the Apostle Paul and his first letter to the church in Corinth, the Corinthians, a church that they certainly needed a whole lot of wisdom. They were giving in to a lot of folly. you read about the church in Corinth, there was some foolish stuff happening. And yet the Apostle Paul takes time, and it's not surprising that in the midst of their folly, the very first chapter, some of the first things he writes in his first letter to this church that has given in to the allure of Lady Folly, he talks about the wisdom of God. And I want to close with a few verses from 1 Corinthians to remind us that as important primary of wisdom is, we can turn wisdom into anything, just like we can cheapen the word love and grace. But we need to understand wisdom as Jesus' life and death frames it. And the Apostle Paul knew this. He writes these words. He says, "The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction. But we who are being saved, ongoing process of growing in our knowledge and grace and wisdom of Jesus. We who are being saved know it is the very power of God. As the scriptures say, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent." So where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish. Since God, in his wisdom, saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom, he has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. It is foolishness to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven, and it is foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended, and the Gentiles say it's all nonsense. But to those who are called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest of human plans, and God's weakness is stronger than the greatest human strength. So yes, we chase after wisdom, we pursue wisdom. The Proverbs tell us that time and time again. But we don't look for a formula. We don't look for something simple that we can just latch on to. We don't even elevate wisdom into a place of idolatry. No, the wisdom of God is tied to the person and the character of Jesus. And that shouldn't surprise us in this grand story. It all connects back to Jesus. And so for those of us who are deeply desiring discernment and wisdom, maybe with a strained relationship right now, it could be with a spouse or a child or a neighbor or an employee or someone on social media. Maybe there's decisions before you that you need to sit in the wisdom about. I would encourage you, alone and with some trusted friends, just to sit at the feet of Jesus, just to listen to what you see Jesus guiding you into, and trust that he has given you the mind of Christ. Don't let fear paralyze you, but don't rush to knee-jerk reactions as well. Sit at the feet of Jesus. Pray. Meditate on Scripture. Talk with trusted friends. And then, with confidence, make a decision that God has put on your heart as we continue to cultivate wise and godly living. At the end of the day, the last thing and the most important thing I want to say this morning is this. If it looks like Jesus, it is wise and loving. If it's self-sacrificial love that's motivating the choices, if it's not motivated by self-centeredness or self-righteousness or having wisdom to win a debate on social media just for the sake of winning a debate, that's not becoming of Christ. The spirit of Christ is the spirit of laying down one's life, of coming down alongside the other to serve. May our church in these unprecedented days be known as a loving church, a wise church, because we look, we think, and we act like Jesus, the one who loved the world without discrimination to the end, giving his life on the cross. Let me close in a word of prayer, and then I'm going to invite Chris to come. And on the heels of last week's message, where we talked about our lives being much like beautiful lyrics being overlaid over a discouraging tune in the world, Chris is going to come and sing Amazing Grace for us. But let's have a word of prayer before I invite him to do that as we wind up. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you indeed are the power of God, but not only the power of God, you express the wisdom of God. And the way you lived your life, the way you walked, the way you served, the people you engaged, the dirty feet of the disciples you washed, the allowing of yourself and your life to be taken, showing us the wisdom of God. Apart from the eyes of faith, the cross looks like foolishness. It looks like failure. It looks like weakness. But through the eyes of faith, of trusting in God, we see that that is the very power and wisdom of God. And so I pray that as a church, we would, in this season of reorienting and reimagining what church and ministry looks like, I pray that we will humble ourselves, that we will take time, as we've been doing around our board table, I know many have been doing this summer, just to sit at your feet, to listen, to reflect, and then to respond wisely, led by your Spirit, in the presence of others in community. That we continue to be a church that represents Jesus well in our neighborhood. Healing hearts, mending families, and caring for this wonderful community. And it's all empowered by your amazing grace. So as we close our time together today, I pray that we would continue to allow the message, the scriptures, to percolate our minds and our hearts so that we can continue to cultivate lives that are wise and look like Jesus. Thank you for your amazing grace. Thank you that long before we loved you, you loved us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite Chris just to lead us in a time of song as we close our time together. Bless us. keep us. May he make his face shine richly upon us, be good to us, give us his peace and his wisdom, so we can live wisely in these uncertain, unprecedented times. In Jesus' name we ask all of this. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Have a wonderful week cultivating wisdom in your life.